And joining me now is Health Minister Chris Hipkins. Minister, can you bring us up to date with the latest in terms of the crew of the Safrana Seville?
What we know is that there have been three positive cases identified on the Safrana Seville over in Australia now. They would suggest that they're at different stages of infection. So one of them was a negative PCR test, but a positive serology test. Another one was a weak positive PCR test and then a positive serology test. The other was a reasonably clear positive on the PCR test. So what that shows is that they're all at different rates of, you know, at different points in the infectious cycle, which would lend itself to the idea that the virus has been circulating around that ship, and that would suggest that that is the most likely source of infection for the workers who worked on it coming back into New Zealand.
Okay, so in terms of that, we have two community cases stemming from a marine engineer who worked on the ship. That's what we were initially told. We were told one of the infected people picked up an infection after spending, 3 minutes or less with the initial case. Do you not believe that to be the case anymore?
The health people who are doing this exercise are taking at our request, a very, very precautionary approach. We want to stop this virus in its tracks. And at this point, you know, the most likely timeline is that the person was infected on Friday before they went to the pub. And so the risk is reasonably low. However, at this point, you can't discount the possibility, given that it's a work colleague or someone who works in the same building as the two people who, you know, cases A and B. You can't discount the possibility that it could have been slightly earlier than that. And so we just want to make sure that we're not leaving anything to chance at this point.
Okay, because this is really important. If the person did pick it up with a fleeting contact, they were initially described as a casual contact who had spent less than 3 minutes with the infected person. Experts are challenging that. I mean, Dr. Susie Wiles has said if that is the case, everything you've been told about casual contacts needs to be rethought, because we've been told 15 minutes and 2 metres, and this would change all of that, wouldn't it?
So I think one of the things that's important here is that new information comes through all of the time. That was certainly one of the possibilities was when we were dealing with case A only, and case C is the person, is one of the people who works in the building. They'd only come into contact for about 2 minutes on the Friday. On the other hand, case B, which initially was not known about, so this was someone who tested positive a bit later in the process. They did have a longer period of contact with that person on the Friday. They were in a meeting together, and so it's possible that that could have been chain of infection there rather than a two-minute fleeting contact.
Or there could be another person, Minister. Is that a possibility still under investigation?
Well, we're testing absolutely everybody, that all of these people have come into contact with. That, thus far, it has not shown up an additional person. But, of course, one of the things that we just want to run down every possibility. So, and it is possible sometimes people show up, negative, and then they show up subsequently positive on a follow-up test. So we're just, we're being very, very precautionary here. That's what I think people would expect us to be doing at this point.
How many people from the pub in Greenhithe have been tested so far?
I haven't had those numbers. That testing is happening today, so I'll get those numbers later on tonight or early tomorrow morning, get an indication of that. All we know is that the person was there with about half a dozen other people. Those are their close contacts. Those people have all been contacted. They were all contacted last night. They will all have been isolating today. They'll be being tested. So we've got to guarantee that the close contacts are being tested. We're pushing out notifications to everybody else who was in the pub at the time.
Yeah.
Where they've been using the QR code, scanner, to make sure that they know they should be getting tested.
Minister, are you a little bit disappointed with the garbled messaging around this?
No, not at all. I think what's really important, Lisa, is that we recognise that in the early stages of a case like this, new information will be adding to the picture all of the time. So,
but can you understand how it's confusing to people to initially be told only the close contacts need to be tested, only the people who are at the pub? Now they're told that their families have to be tested as well, and everybody should stay home until they return a negative test. So there's been different waves of information, and people have been a little bit confused by that.
Look, I think it's really important to note that you get new information all the time. So when the first round of information was released publicly, we weren't aware of case B. So case B tested positive relatively late in the initial investigation process. And so that is the most, at this point, that could well be the link between cases A and B and case C. Now, initially, we knew, that link wasn't clear. So you do get new information. Yes, the facts do change, and therefore the advice does change as the facts change.
When the pub owner went to get a test, it was a 3-hour wait. Is that acceptable? Was told to come back the next day. That would be the best way to handle it.
No, and look, I'll follow that one up. We want people to be able to get tested quickly. Of course, there are a range of different places that they can be tested. New pop-up testing sites have been stood up today in that location to make sure that testing is widely available. And we will be pushing, to make sure that we've got as much testing available over the weekend as possible.
If you're taking a precautionary approach, as you have suggested during the course of this interview, why not make masks compulsory on public transport at level one? Will you do that?
We certainly encourage people to use them at this point.
That's different to compulsion, though, isn't it? And even today, there's a review comparing us to Taiwan. Masks have been a major player in the way they have handled this pandemic. Will you consider making it compulsory at level one?
At this point, there is an evidence that we are dealing with community transmission beyond a very, very small sort of circle of possibility. Were that to broaden, then yes, we would look further at masks. At this point, I don't think we've reached that point yet, but I've asked for further advice on that. And so, we'll get that advice, and then, I will take that to my cabinet colleagues and we will consider that.
Masks would tell people that this is still on our doorstep, though, wouldn't it? And it's about messaging. And Dr. David Skegg has said that, he thinks the messaging is a bit slack, that people have been given the impression that we've defeated this virus and we haven't. Has the foot come off the accelerator a bit in terms of that messaging?
No, look, you'll never hear any of the ministers, the Prime Minister and I, who comment most frequently on this, ever saying that we've beaten the virus. The thing is, this virus can pop back up at any time. We will deal with more cases like the ones that we've been dealing with recently. That is just a reality. We cannot hermetically seal our border. We still need ships coming and going. We still need planes coming and going. So in every protection that we put in place, and we're putting very robust protections in place, nothing is 100% foolproof. So we do have to be prepared to move very quickly when any positive cases like this emerge.
So the fishing crews at the Sedima in Christchurch, they've been sharing accommodation, twin share accommodation. Are you going to stop doing that? Because again, experts say that that is an infection risk and it's sloppy procedure.
The biggest issue there is that if a roommate tests positive, what the effect that that has is it resets the clock for the person who they're sharing a room with. So they're then separated. The person who had not yet been tested positive would then start the 14-day process over again. One of the issues that we looked at with the Sedima is whether we should end the double bunking arrangement and separate people out. And the reason that the people who are running the MIQ decided not to do that in this case was that potentially increases the risk because of the number of staff that would need to be brought in to manage that transition.
Understand that, Minister, but I'm talking about in future. You're dealing with what you've got now because the bed's been made, so to speak. So in the future, will you be putting people in shared accommodation? Because, as mentioned, some epidemiologists say that is sloppy procedure and it defies the whole objectives of quarantine.
That's something that we're looking at. But like I said, it doesn't increase the risk of it being moved into the public. It does increase the risk that people will end up staying in quarantine for longer.
And that's an issue, isn't it? That's more resources, more time, more money for the country or whoever is paying for it.
Ultimately, in this particular case, this is one of the only areas where double bunking is happening. And in this particular case, the New Zealand taxpayer is not paying for that. That's being paid for by the fishing company.
Did you see the pictures of the fishing crews last night out on their balconies, within spitting distance of each other, all smoking and leaning over the rails, in very close proximity to each other? Are you comfortable with the way things are operating there?
No, I haven't seen those pictures. Obviously, as a result of the recent developments in the last few days, we're looking very, very closely at those arrangements to make sure they're as robust as possible.
Should we delay the second wave of fishing crews due here in early November?
They've already been delayed. So my understanding is that the extra charter flight, the next charter flight, will not depart. It will not come to New Zealand until we have space to be able to accommodate those people, which obviously is difficult when some of those people who are currently occupying those beds are likely to be staying there for longer.
So that's an indefinite delay then at this point?
Well, it's a delay until we're ready to receive them, and we're not in the position to receive them at the moment.
And you can't say when you will be, so it is an indefinite delay, isn't it?
Well, it's a delay until we're ready. Yes, that's right.
Appreciate your time, Minister. That is the Health Minister, Chris Hipkins, there.